We're just looking forward to a great time of the Lord today. Appreciate all you being with us. We got several visitors with us today. If you'll make them welcome, Daystar, we appreciate you being here. Encourage you, if you need anything, let us know, and we'll do our best to accommodate and take care of you. If you need anything, just be sure to let one of us know. Appreciate you coming. Let me remind you of a few things that we got going on before we get started. We have prayer in the sanctuary today at 5:30. Please don't forget about that. And tonight will be our discipleship time at 6 o'clock. Prayer meeting tomorrow at 5. We're a church that believes in prayer. There's a power of prayer. God does nothing except an answer to prayer. We also believe in the Word. And on Wednesday night, we have Bible study where we dig in the Word. Start at 7 o'clock here on Wednesday night. And then Saturday, we're trying to get together some shoeboxes for the shoebox ministry, Samaritan's Purse. The motorcycle ministry will be taking those on this coming Saturday. So if you can get that stuff to us, or if you're unable to get it together, if you'd like to just give some money to help, see Whitney or one of the motorcycle ministry folks, and they'll be able to take care of that and get that going on. We also have some needs for the homeless community that we're trying to work through Christian Ministries. I just heard also that the Hesed House is up and going, or getting ready to be up and going. So we've got some folks that are in the community that really have needs, so we want to try to help them. If you can help us pick up some gloves, hats, socks, hand and foot warmers, something like that, bring those by next weekend so that we can take that to Christian Ministries to help folks like that. Next Sunday night after the service, youth are having a soup fundraiser. They're going to be having taco soup, potato soup, veggie beef soup. They got an event coming up, and they want to do some fundraising for that. So if you keep that in mind. And next Sunday morning starts our revival. Brother Adrian Franklin. How many have ever heard Brother Adrian Franklin? All right. If you haven't heard him, it'll be a blessing. Sings, preaches, just a great young man of God. He's also a celebrity now, for those of you that don't know. He made Fox News, CNN News. He's just out there, I'm telling you. He's moving on up in the world. And we'll rag him a little bit about that next week. But be much in prayer this week. I encourage you to invite some folks to come and be a part of the revival. It's always a great time of the Lord just to come together and just get refreshed, revived, renewed. It's just as much for the church as it is for the lost. And I don't know about you, but I need a move of God in my life. Amen? Amen. You need a move of God in your life. So I encourage you to be a part of that and invite some folks to come out. It'll be going through that Friday night. Trunk or Treat is the October the 30th on that Friday night. There's a sign-up sheet on the welcome desk. For those of you that may not know what Trunk or Treat is, basically we line up cars in the parking lot, and you have your own little theme of what you want to do, and it's your setup. So if you can help with that, if you got any questions about it, see Brother Major, Sister Rhonda, one of the girls, Sam or Beth, and they'll be able to tell you more about that. But plan your own theme, and if you can help with candy or things like that, I'm sure that they would have some needs there. So ask them, and they'll be able to tell you more about that. There's the nursery ministry for this week, so please keep this in mind, and we appreciate you coming out. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer and ask him to have his way. We've got several needs and requests that we need to remember. I want to ask you to remember my good friend Ray, who I've worked with for the last 17 years. His wife found out on Friday that she has cancer in her bone. She also has some spots on her lung, and Ray's taking this pretty hard. I've talked to him several times. But remember, Terry, they go to the doctor tomorrow to try to get a treatment plan together, but their fear is that it's too far gone. They've already found it in her spine. And in her spinal area. So remember her, if you will, that God would touch her. Remember Artie Smith. This is Terry Poster's brother. He's in the hospital. They've been doing some work with his heart. He's also on a breathing machine. Last update I got, Terry said that he's breathing about 50% on his own, 50% with a machine. So remember Artie, if you will, and most of all that everything be okay between him and the Lord. So that God will just touch him and minister to him. Remember Rachel Kinninger, this 34-year-old that's in hospice. Also remember our overseer, Jimmy Smith, who broke his collarbone. I also ask you to keep me in prayer Tuesday morning. I have a meeting with him at 10 o'clock on Tuesday morning. So if you would, just pray for the Lord's will to be done in that. And I'll share the details of that with you after the meeting. So just remember the Lord's will to be done in that. Also, Howard Hester, who's dealing with stage 4 cancer. Remember Sister Debbie and Tony, both been fighting a lot of sickness. They've been passing it back and forth with one another. So remember them, if you will. Spoke with them this week, and they really need a touch from the Lord. And Sister Debbie has a surgery that's yet to be scheduled, but it's one that she's got to have on her knee. So remember her. Remember Terry for kidney. There's been a couple of doors that have opened and closed. So we're just continue to pray for the right door to open that God would just have his way in that. So remember Terry, if you will, that God would touch him and minister him. Emily Carpenter, his 12-year-old, has been having seizures. My Aunt Shelby had that cancer removed on Thursday. They went back Friday, and they were doing some grafting of skin and things of that nature to help her with that. She is recovering from that, so continue to pray for her. And my Uncle R.M. also, who's battling cancer, that the Lord would touch him and minister to him. So if you would remember these needs of requests. If you have a need of request that you want to make known at this time, amen. Would you stand and would you join with someone near you? We're going to pray in agreement. Ask God to have his way in our service today. Ask God to have his way in our ministry, the worship ministry, the nursery. Pray for our discipleship tonight, for our kids. Our kids are starting their Christmas program. They're preparing for the Christmas program. We want to pray for those that are involved in the Christmas program, that God would just have his way in that. And pray for our revival starting next Sunday, that God would just move in a mighty way and just speak to us in a powerful way, that God would give some clarity and some direction. Pray for these needs and also the hands that were raised. Pray for those. And pray for me today, that God would give me strength to do what he'd have us to do in this time of the word and time of worship. Father, we love you. We thank you. God, I've just been reminded today that it is your kingdom. God, it is your work. It is your manifestation of your presence, God. It is nothing that I can do in and of myself. But I'm reminded today, God, that I need to allow my kingdom to fall, God, that your kingdom can go forth. And I pray, God, that you would move and manifest your glory and your presence in our lives, God, that we would be directed and led of you and be what you've called us to be. And Father, I just pray in the name of Jesus that you begin to move in this service this morning, God. Help us to be reminded of the greatness of who you are. God, I pray that you would come into this house and feel this house and feel these folks, God. Help us, Lord, to leave this place revitalized, rechanged, God, renewed by your spirit and your presence. I pray in the name of Jesus, Father. We just surrender this time to you. I pray, God, that you would bless our worship team, God, and our musicians and use them in a mighty way. Let your anointing rest on them and move them, God. That they would, God, that they would not lead from a performance perspective, God, but they would lead from a worship perspective. God, that we would be led into the very throne room of God today, God, to be ministered to by your spirit, your presence, your power, God. I lift up those that are working in our nursery today, God. I thank you for their sacrifice to volunteer their time, God, to come and be ministered to by your spirit, Father. I pray that you would move in them and minister to them and touch our children's ministry, Lord, as they're preparing for the children's ministry, for the Christmas program, Lord. I pray that you would touch them and lead them and help them, God, to memorize their lines, God. But more than that, God, to just to be saturated in your anointing, God, that they can bring a gospel message through this Christmas program, God. I pray that your will be done. Father, I pray that you'll lead and direct us here at Daystar, God, that you would manifest your presence, your glory, God, that you would give us great wisdom. Touch our leadership, God, our counsel, Lord. I pray that you would give them great wisdom, great insight. God, that we can move forward in your presence, your power, God. I praise you for that today. Father, I give you glory and honor for this day. I thank you, Lord, that you're the healer. God, that you can heal cancer. God, I know that you can touch Terry today and heal her body and do a mighty work in her. Touch Artie today. Heal his body, God. Give him breath in his body. Touch his heart. Physically and spiritually, Lord, minister to him, I pray, in the name of Jesus. For these other needs that are on our list that are represented for Tony and Debbie today, God, that you'll bring healing to them in the name of Jesus. Touch the overseer, Lord. Minister healing to this collarbone that's broken, God. Let it heal properly, Lord. Let everything be well, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Father, we just surrender this time to you. Father, we give you the praise. We give you the glory, the honor for this, God. This is the day the Lord has made. I will, God, I made my choice to rejoice in you today. I will rejoice and I'll be glad in this day, God, today. I praise you for what you're doing, for what you're going to do, God. We bless your name today. We give you the glory. We give you the honor, the praise. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. And everybody say it. Come on. Everybody say it. Amen. 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 Would you find about 3-4 people, hug their neck? Somebody in this house may need a hug today. Give them a hug. Let them know it's good to see them in the Lord's house as we get ready to worship.
He shall reign. He's alive. They crucified him at Calvary, but he rose in victory. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. alive. They crucified him at Calvary, but he rose in victory.
Under our feet. we can stomp all over his head this morning. He is under our feet because our God is risen and alive in this place today. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for your freedom, God.
Oh, because you rose,
you rose
in glory,
in glory.
All power,
all power,
and glory,
and authority.
You conquered,
you conquered
enemy.
My enemy, and put them under my feet. You rose
in glory,
all power,
all power,
and authority.
You conquered,
conquered
my enemy.
Put them under my feet.
On the third day,
that you got up on the third day. I'm so thankful that you threw off those grave clothes and you walked out of that grave in glory and power and majesty. And now you're seated at the right hand of the Father. Oh, thank you, Jesus. On the third day, he got up. On the third day, he got up. On the third day, he got up. He's alive, he's alive. On the third day, he got up.
On the third day, he got up. On the third day, he got up. He's alive, he's alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
He's alive with all power.
Victory you've won for us through your blood, Jesus. We're here to worship you this morning, God, in all of your glory and all of your majesty, God. We just stand in awe of you today.
You
we sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. For the Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome.
It's your breath. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you.
Be awesome if the church had integrity and really meant what they were singing or what they were saying. Think about this for just a moment. I mean, it is the breath of God. It is God's breath inside of us. God breathed into man and man became a living soul. God has given us the breath that we breathe. You know, I've shared it in this context before, but think about it for just a moment. If on Christmas time you gave your kids a gift, and after they opened up the gift, they looked at it and just kind of threw it over in the corner and never used it anymore, played with it anymore, or utilized it anymore. You know, what a shame, what a waste that would be for you to go out and take your hard-earned money and give them a gift and for them just to nonchalantly cast it to the side. Think about it today. It is the breath of God. It is the opportunity that we exist. The reason that we exist is all because of Him. This song simply says, Lord, it is your breath in my lungs. And so I'm giving back to you, God, what you gave to me. Wow. What a God. Even in greater context, you know, my kids, when they were growing up, they're not grown, but as they were growing up, they would get allowance. And when they got that allowance, it always intrigued me when they would take that allowance and not use it for selfish purposes. But they would take the very allowance that I gave them, and sometimes they would buy me stuff. Christmas gift, a birthday gift, or something. They would take what I gave to them and give back to me. There's no greater joy than that. Think about that. God has given us the breath of life. God has given us the breath of life, the ability to breathe. In him is life, and the life is the light of men. He, in him we live and move and have our being. It's all about him. And if we would understand this and come together, and not only together, but have the integrity, even when we're by ourselves, to be able to say, you know what, God, you've blessed me with life. You've blessed me with breath, God. You've blessed me with my existence, Lord. And I just want to give back to you all that you've blessed me with. What a good God he is. And he's worthy of praise. He's worthy of praise. Now be a good time to praise him. He's worthy of praise. He's giving you the breath and the opportunity to exist and to live for him. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Amen. One more time. Let's tell the Lord we love him. Thank you so much. Praise team. What a powerful, mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Before you're seated, would you grab your Bibles and turn with me? I don't know if this is the third or fourth week that I've been in this one verse of Scripture, but I tell you, there's just Hebrews chapter 12 is where we're at. We've been in this series for a couple of months now, talking about in Christ alone, and every message has been unique in and of itself. So if you've missed any along in the series, you missed that one. But today is a new, fresh opportunity, a new word that's going to speak to you. I do not believe that you showed up today by chance. I don't believe in chance or coincidence when it comes to the things of God. I believe that God orchestrates his plan and pulls things together for distinct purposes so that you can have what you need from him. But I am learning more and more that the more I'm in Christ, the more I'm hid in him, the more I abide in him, the more my life makes sense. The more I realize that my existence in and of itself is unfruitful, but when I exist and live and abide in him, that's where I find peace and joy and rest and healing, transformation, reviving of my soul, my spirit, my heart. And I find that he's a great God. He's a great God. So we've been talking about in Christ alone, but for the last 3 weeks, we've been really focusing on Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. We talked about several different aspects of this particular verse, but let's start with verse 1 and go through verse 3, and just to get the context of what the writer's saying here. And then we're going to focus in on verse 2. And we're going to try to focus on that last portion of the verse and see if we can dig into that just a little bit deeper. God really spoke to me about this particular portion of this verse, but let's start with verse 1. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily beset us or ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus. We talked about that a few weeks ago. The author and the finisher of our faith. That was the second message on this verse. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. We talked about that last week. This is a portion that we're going to pick up with today. Despising the shame. Despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. Consider him who endured such hostility from sinners. He went through this and endured this hostility for you and for me. And he's saying, listen, I went through that so you don't have to. I endured that affliction so you don't have to. I went through that weariness. I went through that discouragement. I went through that pain and that shame so you don't have to. I come to say something to somebody today, and it's a very clear message. If you don't hear anything else I say today, please hear this portion right here. Some of you are carrying things you were never meant to carry. Some of you are abiding in areas of life and living and just mental oppression that Jesus faced that hostility, took that shame, took that guilt, took all that stuff so you don't have to. And I'm declaring today you can be free. Today you can be free. You can be liberated because Jesus despised that shame. Jesus despised that shame. And that word's going to mean a lot more to you here in about 15, 20 minutes. But he despised that shame. And that's where I want to minister from today. Father, we love you. We thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. I pray, God, that you would help me today to do what you've called me to do. Father, to live as you call me to live, to come before these folks today and to declare this word, God, that you are declaring over these folks here. God, again, I say that it's not by chance or by coincidence that you have brought them to this place. There are some folks here today, God, that are weighed down with things and stuff and hostility and just they are ensnared, God. And today you have come to set the captive free. Today, God, you have come to release their minds and their heart and their thinking, God, that they can be liberated to be all that you've called them to be, that they can be liberated, God, to walk in the fullness of who you are, God, that they can rest in you and abide in you, God, and live in you and move in you and have their being in you, God. I'm praying today, God, that you would help us to have a deeper understanding of what it is that you're speaking to us from this particular verse today. God, that we would grasp this message. God, that we would live in this message, abide in this message, I pray in the name of Jesus. Help us to do all that we do, God, to look to you. You're the author. You're the finisher. Help us, God, to understand that you had joy of the cross, the endurance of the cross. God, if no other message gets clear today, let us know, God, that you despised the shame. We thank you, Father. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. And we ask it in Jesus' name today. And everybody said, amen. As you're being seated, turn to your neighbor and say, you were never meant to carry that. You were never meant to carry that. I had to come out of my coat, folks. It's hot up here. There are a lot of things, when I look back over the history of my life in the last 42 years, that I am not proud of. There's a lot of things in my life that I look back of actions that I committed, things that I've said, people that I've hurt. There's a lot of things that if I would allow myself, it would bombard me and wreck my mind and my thinking and my heart and totally cripple me from being everything God's called me to be. There was a time in my life that I carried a lot of shame, a lot of guilt. There was times that I wouldn't talk about certain things. There were times that I wouldn't bring certain subjects up because I was not so much guilty of the action of it at that moment, but I was carrying the guilt and the shame of it. That I didn't want to bring it to light because I didn't want to be found out. I didn't want to be recognized. I didn't want nobody to see me for what I used to be. I wanted to present this image of perfect. I wanted to present this image of being right. I wanted to present this image of everything was okay, everything was good, but the more I tried to present that image, the more of a wreck, the more of a mess I really became. Because now I had to go from being broken and poured out at an altar where I lay down my sin, I laid down my shame, my guilt, where I lay those. Now I'm having to live behind a facade, a mask, to continue to present this religious facade of who I was out of fear that somebody might find out who I really am or who I really was. I never took it into consideration that Jesus did what he did. The faith that I demonstrated to come and ask him to be the Lord of my life was sufficient in of itself for the moment, but I did not continue to walk in that same faith to understand that not only did he save me from that moment, but he saved me from my history and eradicated my sin and my guilt and my shame. I didn't want to talk about that. I didn't want to talk about my shortcomings. I didn't want to talk about my failures. I didn't want to talk about it and bring it to light. But I read, there's a verse of scripture in the book of Galatians that totally transformed my thinking when he said, when we confess our faults one to another, that we can be healed. You know, to be able to say, hey, this is who I was. This is where I was when Jesus found me. You know, I like what the psalmist David said when David said, you know, he brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet up on a rock. Now, listen, folks, I've been down in holes where the hole is dug out. And Michael, my brother-in-law, he works on road crews. And I'm sure he's been in holes and rain or water and mud and getting out. When you get brought up out of there, you're not a clean thing. You know, it's nothing that you can clean. And the psalmist David said, he brought me up out of that horrible pit. He brought me up out of that miry clay. And he set my foot on a rock and he established my goings. God did this for me. And when I stood before him, as I was resurrected, if you will, out of that hole, out of that place, I stood there a dirty, filthy, unclean thing. And yet in the midst of all the crud in my life, Jesus still loved me. He saw me for what I was. And all of a sudden, I realized that his opinion of me was that he loved me. That he saw beyond all my stuff, and he loved me. So this is the real question that I have for us today. If Jesus sees us for who we are, and he sees all our crud, and he sees all our junk, and he sees all our stuff, and he loves us beyond that, and we understand that his opinion of us is that in spite of you, and in spite of your stuff, in spite of your mess, I love you anyway, then why are we so afraid of the opinion of people? Why do we fear what somebody may think of us or see of us when the one that really matters, the one that really has the final say-so in our life, the one that's able to destroy both body and soul in hell, the one that has the final word on our life, why are we worried about people? Why do we hide in shame and guilt and distress, worrying about the facade, worrying about you know, what people may say or what people, why do we worry about that? Well, the writer of Hebrews said that he despised the shame. You know, when I think of the word despise, instantly my mind thinks he hated it. He abhorred it. He didn't want to have anything to do with it. When I look at that word and I think about despising something, there's things I despise. Y'all all know me, or most of you know me. You know I despise green beans. Don't want them. Don't want anything to do with them. Despise them. And so when I put it in the context of green beans for me, and I think about the shame that Jesus despised, he despised the shame. And it would be very easy to go off on this tangent and say, he really didn't want to do it. He really didn't want to have to go. He despised the fact that he even had to go into it. He despised the fact that he had to go to that cross. He despised the fact he was even asking the Lord, Lord, if it's your will, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but your will be done. You know, we think about that and we say, oh, he despised the fact that he had to go there. No, he embraced the fact that he had to go through it. He embraced the fact that he had to endure it. Remember, he said it was the joy that was set before him that he endured the cross. So I did a word study on despised because I wanted to find out exactly what the meaning of this word was. And the meaning of the word has nothing to do with hating. The meaning of the word means he discounted it as nothing. He discounted it as nothing. He took the shame and said, the shame is nothing. That stuff that you've been carrying, that stuff that's been holding you down, that stuff that you've been going through, he went through what he went through on that cross and brought it to nothing. The shame, the guilt, the pain, the horrificness of what you worry about, to put the facade on that you're concerned that somebody might find you out. Jesus said, I'm discounting that to nothing. If you'll just give it to me, I'll take that shame, I'll take that guilt, and I'll bring it to nothing. He bore that. He took that. He held that and he embraced that so that you didn't have to carry it. He brought it to nothing. Now again, you say, well, preacher, okay, that's good. So let me just recollect for just a moment. I was a fornicating, gambling, pornography addicted, selfish, egotistical, maniacal kind of person, that I carried all that stuff, bound by lust, bound by pride, bound by a heart that was just afflicted with self. And I can stand before you and say those things today because he bore my shame.
I'm not proud of it. It's not what I want to be known as. It's not, but that's what he saw, folks, when he reached into that pit and brought me out. But yet he, in his justice and his mercy and his grace and his love, reached down in that pit and got me up and set me on a rock and established my going. God did that for me, folks. And so I don't have to hide behind a facade or a mask or worry about what you think of me or what you say about me. Jesus has already given his opinion of me, and he said, I love you. I saved you. I bought you with a price. You are not your own anymore. You belong to me. You're my son. You're my son. And for the female folks in here, you're his daughter. And he's saying, I love you. I love you. You don't have to carry this shame. You don't have to carry this guilt. You don't have to carry this pain. So let's paint the picture. Isaiah, in Isaiah 53, we see where the Bible says that he endured what he endured for us. He grew up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of dry ground, and he has no form of comeliness. And when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised, rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs. Surely he's carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Folks, listen, this is not a fable or a story that I'm telling you this morning. It happened in reality that Jesus went to that cross, beaten and battered and bruised, shamed, hung half naked on a cross before all to see, and was afflicted for the very purpose that you wouldn't have to carry it and go through it. But he came that you might have life and have it more abundantly, that you can live in the power of freedom and peace that passes all understanding, and joy unspeakable and full of glory. God has done that for you. Surely he bore our griefs. Surely he carried our sorrows. We esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, afflicted. For you and for me, that I don't have to carry this stuff. I don't have to carry this stuff. David prophesied in Psalm 22. He said, they cried to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not ashamed. But I'm a worm. I'm no man. A reproach of men and despised by people. David said, listen, all those who see me, they ridicule me. They shoot out the lip. They shake the head saying, he trusted in the Lord. Let him rescue him. Let him deliver him since he delights in him. David is prophesying here. Prophesying not only of his current situation, but of the situation that was to come with Jesus. They stood there at the base of that cross. They said, oh, you be the Son of God, save yourself. Come on, healer, heal yourself. Come on, deliverer, bring yourself down. Come on, let's see what you can do. Show him you're the Son of God. David said, I'm going through this, but my Lord's going to go through this. Go back to that first part of that first verse of Psalm 22 there, buddy. They cried to you and they were delivered. They trusted you. And we're not ashamed. Let me tell you something. When you get to a place where you know that you're in that perfect utopia of the will of God, you don't have to live in shame. The Bible said in Genesis chapter 2, I believe it was, in the latter portion, they said they were both naked and they were not ashamed. Why? Because they were in that perfect place of peace and rest with God. They were in that perfect place where they knew that their sins, that there was no sin, that they had this relationship, that God would come down and walk with them in the cool of the day. The Bible said that they were both naked and not ashamed. Let me tell you something, folks. You don't have to be ashamed. You don't have to carry shame. You don't have to carry guilt. You don't have to worry about the elements of your past. I'm telling you, the blood of Jesus was sufficient enough to eradicate it all. The blood and the power of the cross, of what Jesus did on that cross, swapped it all away. Listen, I'm telling you, it takes as far as the east is from the west, never to be remembered against you anymore. People might bring it up. The devil might bring it up. But you can look at the devil and say, my God nailed it to the cross. He made an open spectacle. He brought it to shame. He brought it to naught. My God buried it just for me. Baby, if you got my text, Colossians chapter 2, the Bible says, that Jesus did this. He said, you being dead in your trespasses and in the uncircumcision of flesh, he's made alive together with him and have forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way and he nailed it to the cross. He's disarmed the principalities and powers. He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them. Listen, this is what Jesus did. He took those sins. He took that stuff. He took that shame. He took that guilt and he nailed it to the cross so that you and I could come out in victory, triumphant for the glory of God. I'm telling you today, friend, we better shake ourselves and realize that I'm not just any human being, but I'm a child of the King, bought and purchased by the blood of the Lamb, and God has set me free and at liberty to be everything he's called me to be. He took my shame, he took my guilt, nailed it to the cross, made a public spectacle of it. Listen, now what do you got to be ashamed about? I found in counseling, when you sit down with folks and the well of shame and guilt begins to open up, they begin to tell you stuff they never would have told you before. But because the door of opportunity was there and all they longed for all along was to be free, they begin to talk about stuff that wasn't even a subject of the matter, but it was freeing to them. When I was going through the ordeal I went through, I went to counseling for a year with a clinical psychologist, sat down with him, a Christian man. He began to talk to me, and I went all the way back and dug deep in my heart and my life, and I began to talk about stuff that happened in my life when I was 9, 10, 11, 12 years old, and we started there, and we just dug it up and got it uprooted so that as I sat there before this man, a man that I respected, a man that I knew, I began to talk to him and pour out my heart, and he didn't even have to ask me the question. I just began to talk about it. You know why? Because I carried it long enough. I made up my mind. I carried it long enough. There wasn't no sense in carrying it any longer. I was found out now. I was exposed. I might as well let everybody know what I was and how I was. I'm telling you, friend, there's a place that you can come to the base of the cross of Calvary and you can pour out your life and your heart to him and say, God, I've been exposed. I've been made known. God, the people might know who I am, but I don't care anymore. God, I know that I'm purchased by you. I'm bought by you. And if I'm going to be effective for the kingdom of God, Lord, I got to lay it all down that I can pick up the things of God. I can pick up the power of God. I can pick up and walk in the anointing of God. I got to lay it down so that I can take up the things of you, Lord, and be everything you call me to be. Can't carry shame in a cross. You can't carry guilt in a cross. Wish I had my cross back in here this morning. Can't carry two things at one time, folks. The cross in and of itself is weighty enough, if you will, that I can't put my hands around the cross and keep my hands on my shame and my guilt. Jesus brought that to nothing so that I could take up my cross and follow him and be everything he's called me to be. David said in Psalm 69, 18 to 20, he said, draw near to my soul and to redeem it. Deliver me because of my enemies. You know my reproach, my shame, my dishonor, my adversaries are all before you. Reproach has broken my heart and I'm full of heaviness. I looked for someone to take pity, but there was none. And for comforters, but I found none. Think about this, folks. Jesus hanging on a cross. This prophetic utterance by the psalmist David. He's hanging there suspended between heaven and earth. The religious crowd are reviling on him. The religious crowd are talking about him. The religious crowd are running him down. The disciples that he was closest to are now hiding in fear. And he looks toward heaven, and there's one point in that moment that he looks toward heaven and he cries, God, God, why are you forsaking me? He said, this reproach has broken me. I'm full of heaviness. I look for somebody, please, take pity on this wretched soul. Take pity on this broken body, please. But there was nobody. He went through the shame and this humiliation, folks, so you don't have to. You don't have to. You can find a comforter now. You can find healing now. You can be restored now. There just has to come to a point that you say, this is what I am, God. But you got to take me for what I am and make me what you want me to be. There has to come a point in your life that you declare, God, enough is enough. I'm tired of facades. I'm tired of masks. I'm tired of hiding behind religious walls. I'm tired of coming into church and looking the part but not feeling the part. I'm tired of it. I'm tired of putting on airs for everybody just to keep people off my back. I'm tired of putting on these things and trying to be what people think I ought to be so that everybody be pleased with my performance. talking to somebody today. I feel the Holy Ghost telling me to tell you that you don't have to perform any longer. You can be real with yourself, and you can be everything God's called you to be. You don't have to live behind the facade of shame or guilt, but God has come to redeem you from that and set you free from that. Jesus already went through that stuff so that you don't have to live there. My God has set you free. Come out behind that religious mask and put on a face of freedom and declare, my God has set me free. Preacher, what will people say? Does it matter? What will people think? Does it matter? What if they find out I'm not really what I presented myself to be? Does it matter? The one that really matters already knows. He despised the shame. He brought it to nothing. He brought it to nothing. Isaiah, one of the most powerful prophets to depict the sufferings of Christ. In Isaiah 49, 6 and 7, he said, indeed, he says, it is too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. I will also give you as a light to the Gentiles that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth. But look what he says in verse 7. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel, their Holy One, to him whom man despises, to him whom the nation abhors, to the servant of rulers, kings shall see and arise. Princes also shall worship because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, and he has chosen you. Go back to verse 6, please. Look what it says. He's going to be a light to the Gentiles. He's going to be salvation to the ends of the earth. Keep going, please. Verse 7, he says, listen. He says, the Redeemer of Israel, the whole man despises him. The nation abhors him. But he's the servant of rulers. And kings are going to rise up and see. Princes are going to worship. Because the Lord who is faithful, the Lord who is the Holy One of Israel, get this last part, he has chosen you. Preacher, I'm just not worthy. He chose you. Preacher, my life's a mess. He chose you. Preacher, I really messed up. I dropped the ball. He chose you. And let me tell somebody this morning, he hasn't changed his mind about you. What went on in your life is what went on, but God can set you free. He chose you. The Bible said that he chose you from the foundation of the world. He chose you. He knew you was going to mess up, but he still chose you. He knew you were going to be a mess, but he still chose you. He knew that you were going to give him a test, but he still chose you. He took your test and made it a testimony. He took your mess and made it a message. I'm telling you, my God is able to do exceeding abundant above all that you ask or even think. I'm telling you, my God has all power in heaven and earth, and he can save to the guttermost. My God is able to deliver you and set you completely and totally free. God is able to raise you up, and God's able to give you a name that's above every name. I'm telling you, God can give you a new name. God can give you a new identity. God can help you to walk in the fullness of who he is if you'll just trust in him with all your heart. God can do it. God can do it. I find it interesting that throughout Scripture we label people with who their past is. We call Rahab the harlot, but yet God used her. We call Jacob the deceiver, but yet God used him. We think of Moses as the stutterer and the one that killed the Egyptian, but yet God still used him and made him a man of mighty valor. We think of David the adulterer, but yet one of the greatest kings to ever sit on the throne of heaven, the throne of Israel. Think about that for just a moment, folks. We label people with their failure. We think of Peter as the denier, but yet upon this rock I'll build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. I'm going to use you, Peter. I know you're going to deny me. I know you're going to mess up, but I'm going to use you to build the kingdom. He knows what you are. David said he knows our frame. It's but dust. He knows who you are. He knows how bad you are. But yet he chose you. I don't know what he finds in me. He did. He did. I don't know what he sees in me. He did. What did he see in me, preacher? Well, it wasn't me he saw. He saw he who abides in me. You see, God, whew, my God, God has put his son in my life and allowed his son to become the picture of what I need to be. And as I allow him to reflect that in my life, when God looks at me, he sees his son. He sees the sacrifice of his son. He sees the blood of his son. He sees one that's been washed. He sees one, but this is the most beautiful part of it. The Bible said that he's made us the apple of his eye. He sees the reflection of who he is in us. I'm telling you, friend, God has purchased you and bought you to be everything he's called you to be. Now you need to understand that. And in that principle, abide. Just stand there. God, I don't know why, but you did, and here I am. Here I am. Isaiah 50, 6 and 7, he said, I gave my back to those who struck me and my cheeks to those who plucked out the beard. I did not hide my face from shame and spitting. Please go back. I did not hide my face from shame and spitting. He said, I'm taking it. I'm taking it face on. I'm taking it on the forefront. I'm taking it. I'm enduring it. I'm giving it. I'm doing everything. I'm not backing down for this. I'm not hiding my face from this. I've got to go face first. I got to go head on, head strong, and endure this so that you can go free. I did not hide my face from shame and spitting. Verse 7, for the Lord God will help me. Therefore, I will not be disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I will not be ashamed. That's the determination every one of us have to have in here today. I'm setting my face like a flint. I am not going to be disgraced. He bore that for me so I didn't have to live that way. I would to God that every person sitting in this building today would get your backbone like a saw log and stand flat-footed. Look the devil in the face and tell the devil long enough. This has been long enough for you to hold me down in oppression from being the fullness of what God has called me to be. You better look the devil flat-footed and say, I will not be disgraced. I will not be ashamed. Yes, I committed that act. Yes, I went through that time. Yes, I said those things, but I am not that person anymore. I am redeemed. I am purchased. I am bought. I am washed. I am cleaned by the blood of the Lamb, and that's not what I am, and I will not hide under the burden of sin and shame any longer, but God has redeemed me and set me free to be a liberty. Oh my God, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There's power when God's Spirit abides. You don't have to live there anymore. I will not be disgraced. I will not be ashamed. I am unashamed. Stephanie, I thought about you this morning as I was praying over this message. If you're on Twitter, Stephanie's handle is Mrs. Unashamed. She lets anybody and everybody that follows her know, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. You don't have to be ashamed of this thing. Listen, it bought you, it purchased you, it washed you, it cleaned you, and it can do the same sinner, same for another sinner. You, when you were found, you were not perfect, you were not great, you were not wonderful, but what God did for you through his Son, Jesus Christ, he wants to do for the whole world, because he is not willing that any should perish, but that all come to everlasting life. God wants to do it for you, your mama, your daddy, your uncle, your aunt, your cousin, your nieces, your nephews, your friend, your son, your daughter. He wants to do it for you. Your wife, your husband. He wants to totally and completely set you free. This is what he did. Can we go a little deeper in this picture? Matthew 26. We see Jesus is getting prepared to go through this time of shame and disgrace. And the Bible said they spit in his face and they beat him. But folks, I want to stop here just a moment. Somebody going to have a bad day and they spit in my face. Can I get somebody that agree with me? You had a bad day, you spit in my face. I wouldn't advise it. Now, I've had a few preachers spit on me, and I buck and shout. But anyway, that's a different thing. Some of you been spit on by me. Can I get a witness in the front row? Amen. Yeah. But it wasn't intentional. Sometimes I just can't help it. It comes out with the words. But anyway, if somebody spit in my face, they had a bad day. But you think about this, folks. They spit in the face of the Savior. Can you just let that sink in for just a moment? They spit. They spit in the face of a Creator. They spit in the face of the one that was there when God said, let us make man in our own image. The very one that gave them life, now they're spitting in his face. Spit in his face. And not only did they spit in his face, they beat him and slapped him. I was in fifth grade, Joel. I had three guys that jumped me in the playground at the school. Two held me against the fence, and one mercifully just kept slapping me. As other people stood around and watched, Roger, they slapped me till I blacked out. I went unconscious. They just kept slapping me. Nobody came to my rescue. And I've never been more humiliated in all my life. And I've never really talked about this publicly. But I've never been more humiliated in all my life as two men held me, or two young boys held me against the fence. And one man just mercilessly slapped me and kept slapping me until literally I blacked out. When I got up on my ground, I went in shame and I hid. But I made a determination that day. I was the runt in school. I was a small guy. And there's times that my pride and my cockiness, my arrogance comes out. And I'll be honest with you, it's a facade. It's a facade. And that's where it started, Raj. I thought to myself, ain't nobody going to pick on Joy anymore. I might not do nothing about it, but I'm gonna present the image that you don't want to mess with me. You don't want to mess with me. My sister Carmen was with a guy, and I remember riding down in the car with him. And this is what he said, Brother Jim, I can't tell you one real fight I've ever been in my life. I can't tell you one time that I've ever messed with anybody. I don't like contention. I don't like fighting. I don't like arguing. I don't like it. I like to argue with my wife because we get to make up. But other than that, I don't like contention. But I was riding down the car with Carmen and this other guy, and I looked at that guy, and, you know, big, bad, bold me. I said, boy, you ever hurt my sister? He said, oh, listen, Joe, I've heard about you. I've heard about you. Don't you worry. I won't ever hurt your sister because I've heard about you. And I'm, you know, all of a sudden, I'm sitting there going, he's heard about me. Wow, that's pretty good right there. I didn't know anybody was talking about me, and he's heard about me. But I made up my mind in fifth grade. I wasn't going to be that kid pinned against the fence anymore. I wasn't going to be that kid getting slapped around anymore. I wasn't going to be that one that was brought to that kind of shame and that kind of humiliation. But there come a point in my life that I was pinned back against that fence again, just in a different way. And for 3 years of my life, I did things that I don't even want to talk about. And the devil was just slapping me around, just humiliating me and shaming me again. Still going to church, still playing in the church band. Sitting up there in front of everybody, hiding behind that macho facade, hiding behind that big man facade, smallest guy in the room. Thought I was all that. Just sitting up there all big, bad, and macho. You ever seen one of them gangster movies where all of a sudden the boss comes in with his entourage and all these big, burly men are walking around, and all of a sudden this midget walks in the room? And he's supposed to be the big, bad mama jumbo, you know what I'm talking about? And he just walks in all cocky and arrogant. That's the way I felt. Listen, I'm not happy to tell you this. But I went through that time in my life and let the devil slap me around. I didn't want to talk about stuff. Let me tell you what happened. Even though I went to Jesus and I asked Jesus to forgive me, after I realized Jesus forgave me, the hardest problem I had was forgiving myself. I couldn't forgive myself. So even though I had the opportunity to be free, I still wasn't free. And guess what it did? It pinned me down to the point that I convinced myself that I could never be anything else because this was my identity. Oh, I went to church. I shouted. I preached. I sang. I did all those things. But deep down inside, behind all that stuff, that shame and that guilt held me down. And I said to myself, I'll never be any more than what I am right now. And the shameful thing is that I was so convinced that that's what I was. And that's all I knew. And that's all I ever knew to be. That I went right back into that lifestyle because that's the only place that I was identified with. And I had to go back through that whole shame process again. I had to go back through that whole process of coming before God again and saying to God, Lord, you got to help me here because this is not what I want to be. This is not the life I want to live. I'm preaching now, God. I'm singing. I'm watching people get saved. I'm watching people get delivered. I'm watching people get healed. But yet, God, I'm up here behind this pulpit in a facade, hiding behind a mask, being what everybody thinks I ought to be. I'm just living a lie, hoping on a dream. I need you to set me free, God. I'm not going to go into the story. Y'all have heard it. But I got exposed. My wife found out, confronted me. And I had to go through this process of healing and restoration. Sat down for ministry for a year and just had to let God begin to do some things in me. I'm here to tell you today, and I would love to get to the last portion of this verse, but I'm not going to get there. But I just feel like God's speaking to somebody today. And let me speak to you as somebody who's on the other side of this. I'm not declaring to you today that I am completely free from sometimes the pride and the arrogance and wanting to be the big guy walking into the room so that nobody can take advantage of me. Because I still deal with that, and there's still some times that I have to put that under subjection. There's still times I have to say to myself, you in yourself, son, you're not all that. I have to be reminded of myself. This is what you were, son. You're humbled before the cross of Christ, and you don't have to live this life anymore. I don't have to carry that shame. I don't have to worry about being that fifth grader being slapped around on the fence. I don't have to be that guy anymore. I don't have to present that tough image. I can just be me. I can be what God's called me to be and recognize that He saved me from something. Can I see your hand in here if you're saved? If you're saved, thank you. All across this room, let me tell you something. If you raise your hand and say, I'm saved, you were saved from something. Why are we sitting here acting like we got it all together? We were saved from something. You weren't saved from perfection. Do you hear me? You weren't saved from perfection. Boy, I'm glad God found me when He did, boy, because I was about to bust perfection right out the door when He found me. It's a good thing He brought me along and humbled me and made me realize that I'm not perfect. Well, I was about to step through the threshold of perfection. I was about to be all that in a bag of chips. No, you was a mess. A wretched, sinful mess. Preacher, you're supposed to talk nice to us on Sunday morning. I'm trying. But I'm trying to remind you that you were a mess, and Jesus went through this stuff, spitting, slapping, beating, bruised, wounded, chastising, went through all that stuff, folks, so that you don't have to hide behind a facade of shame. Now, there's many folks in this room this morning, and I'm going to tell you right now, you can decide right now in this moment. Come on, Kels. You can decide in this moment right now. Do I receive this free gift of grace and mercy? Do I receive this free gift that God's given to me? It's nothing that I can do for it, nothing I can do to earn it. Everything that I have is given to me by Him. Do I receive this opportunity to walk free today? Take off this facade, take off this mask, and lay it on this altar and die to all that stuff and realize that He has come to give me life and to give it more abundantly? Or do you want to continue to walk around like the big kid in the block, knowing behind all that it's just a weak, debilitated frame of a person who's in need of a Savior? How you want to live today? Let me remind you that He despised that shame. He discounted it for nothing. He took it and He bore it and He nailed it to the cross. Everything that was brought up against you, every handwriting, every requirement of the law that says you're to die, every handwriting of the requirement that says you're to suffer for what you've done, you're to suffer for those sins, every one of them. The Bible said He took them and He nailed it to a cross. Nailed it to a cross. It's not yours to carry. It's not yours to bear. He took it so you didn't have to. And He's saying to you today, lay it down. Lay it down. Don't carry it anymore. I took your shame. I took your guilt. so you don't have to. There are good, well-meaning Christian folks sitting in this room right now. You are handicapped because of a divorce or a premarital relationship or action. You are handicapped because the enemy just keeps bombarding you and beating you up with stuff that you never thought you would ever do, or stuff that you never want anybody to find out. And I've come to tell you today that God has come to set you free. How do I know that? Because I'm on the back end of some of this process of my own life. I'm not there yet. But I am absolutely not where I was. And God is working for me. He is working for me. And all these things are working for my good. I'm telling you today, you don't have to live in that place. You don't have to allow that to be your identity. You don't have to allow that to be what people name you to be. You can be named as a child of the King. Your failure, your heartache, your past, that stuff does not have to hold you captive anymore. You are a child of the King. You were not meant to bear what you're bearing. And so I'm going to make this very simple this morning. This context of this service has been very pointed to one avenue and one area. But it is general in nature because it can be multiple things across this room. So I'm saying to those of you that remain, how much longer do you want to be held captive? How much longer do you want to live in that place where you feel like you have no ability to live to the fullness of what God has called you to live to? How much longer do you want to be there? You see, he went through all of that. And that final portion of that verse said, now he is set down at the right hand of God. He is living in full majesty. They sang about it. He is forever at the right hand of God in the fullness of who he is. And he has demonstrated to us that I can take this and I can take it to the throne and I can go before the Father and you can go free. You can go free. You got a heart for people. You got a heart for ministry. You got a heart to do. But you just feel like, man, if I get out there, I'm just going to be a hypocrite. If I get out there and start doing, if I get out there and start talking, I can't witness, I can't talk about it because I'm just going to be a hypocrite. Listen, you don't have to live under that oppression anymore. Christ has come to make you free. And the Bible said that he came to make all things new. So why don't you come in and trade in that old jalopy of a life, that broke down Pinto of a life that you think is just going to get you from point A to point B, and walk into this new life, or whatever vehicle you want it to be. I don't really care for a Rolls Royce life. I kind of like a Ford truck life. Amen. If you want Rolls Royce, you ask God. Maybe he'll give it to you. I don't know if he will or not. But you need to trade in an old jalopy. Some of y'all are walking around in a Pacer. Some of you older folks, you know what a Pacer is. You know why Pacer had all those windows around it? So everybody could see the idiot that bought it. Only the old people are laughing because y'all don't want to know what a Pacer is. Why don't you trade that in and say, God, I want everything you've got for me. And disconnect yourself from it. Lay aside that weight, that sin. Lay it aside that you can get in a race. Preacher's too late for me. No, it's not. It is absolutely not too late. It is time to get in the race because this thing is coming to the finale. It's time to get in the race, folks. It's time to quit sitting over there in a pit stop hoping that they can get it up and running, your old jalopy. No, trade that thing in. Get you a new one. Say, come on, God, give me something new here. Give me a freshness in life. Give me a new opportunity. I can be released from this junk and this garbage. Let me just go ahead and send it to the scrapyard, put it at the cross, and leave it there so that I can get this new life that you said I could have. I'm talking to Saint and sinner here. I ain't talking just, I'm talking to Christians. There's some of you, you are weighed down with junk and garbage. God's telling you to run. Time to run. Now, if anybody here owned a Pacer and you got offended at me a while ago, I'm sorry. Or a Gremlin. Might know what a Gremlin is. Same old car. Same car, less windows. But how about it? How about giving this mess to him today and say, God, take my mess and make it a message. Take my test, make it a testimony. Take my shame, take my guilt. It's not for me to carry. It's not for me to worry about what people say or people think or people do. Doesn't matter anymore. I'm giving it to you, Jesus. I'm trading in this old and I'm taking up some new. I'm going to be everything you call me to be. So without any more shame, without any more guilt, without any more pressure, without any more fear, without any more worry, is there somebody here that would be brave enough to say, Pastor, I walked in this door today, and God has exposed me through the Spirit and the power of His Word, and I realize that I don't need to live the way I've been living, and I want to be free before I leave this building today. If there's somebody that would be bold enough to say, that's me, would you get from your feet and just come and stand right here? I know this is a bold step, but you don't have to live like this. Come on, sis. She's not the only one. God has exposed me through His Word and through His Spirit today, and I'm just ready to come clean. I'm just ready to not deal with the shame and the guilt any longer. I'm not ready to deal with the stuff any longer. That'll work. I'm tired of wearing the mask. I'm tired of putting on the facade. I'm tired of what people are thinking about me. Tired of it. Tired of worrying about this, that. I've got one opinion in my life that matters the most, and that's the opinion of Christ. And now that I've been exposed, I'm going to take this opportunity, and I'm going to come clean. I'm trading in that old life, and I'm going to begin to walk in new. If I went through everything I went through for these three, I'm fine. But I believe there's somebody else that would say, Pastor, that's me. I don't want to live like that anymore. I don't want to live in that shame anymore. I don't want to live with that guilt anymore. I'm tired of worrying about what people may see me as. I'm coming out. And I'm going to be free for the glory of God. Is there anybody else before I turn the solo service in a different direction? Anybody else? God's dealing with you. You want to give it to Him. Would you stand? Would you stretch your hands this way? Can I get some sisters to come and help me pray with these? It's not yours to carry anymore.
Everything I once held dear, I count it all.
myself, I belong to you. Lord, lead me. Lead me to the cross.
Somebody give the Lord praise for the great things He has done. Come on, for the great things He has done. For the great things He has done. Wow. Wow. What bravery, what courage to step out and say, that's me. I'm here. God has orchestrated this moment for me. Woo! I'll tell you what I told my sister. God loves us enough that he would orchestrate an entire meeting to get to one. Wow. What love. What love. My Lord, what love. Give me some of that. That's what I'm talking about. You with me? You with me? That's what I'm talking about.
I do it out here with you.
All right. Man, the devil is a lie. I believe we ought to take the devil and put him on the fence and slap him around in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Woo, boy, I am thankful today. I feel free today. You feel that? Man, it's like, whew, just a breath of fresh air, man. I'm telling you. Wow. What a God. What a God. I don't know what he's up to, folks, but he's up to something good. Amen. Amen. Now, just for you three, just for a moment, okay, let me give you a mini sermonette. I don't preach many of them, but live in this moment right here and move forward in this moment right here. Disconnect from this moment. Lay aside those weights. Lay aside that shame. Lay aside that stuff and just go ahead and disconnect and attach to him. Take that cross and say, Lord, I'm going to carry this now, and I'm going to carry it for you. I'm going to be everything you want me to be. I'm going to dig in your word and see what you're giving me. I'm going to dig in your promise. I'm going to get in my prayer closet. I'm going to see what you're saying to me. You've begun this conversation, Lord. I want you to finish this conversation with me. This is just the beginning of a conversation he wants to have with you. There's going to be those private, intimate moments that he wants to speak to you that you're not going to get it in a crowd, but it's going to be God saying, whisper, come close to me and spend some time with me. Let me talk to you. Let me show you something in the Word. Let it be revealed. There's stuff, I'm going to be honest with you, there's stuff that I have preached for the last 22 years. And in just the last 6 months, I've read it and it went, wow. I never knew it said that. It is awesome. Let him, if he started his conversation, he come and knocked on every one of your hearts. He started this conversation with you. Don't think this is a finale of a conversation. This is at the beginning of a conversation. That he wants to live and talk with you every day for the rest of your life and give you direction and instruction and wisdom and guidance and understanding so you can live free and liberty. He's not coming to put more on you. He's taking off of you that you can put on the Lord Christ Jesus and live in the fullness of who he and be clothed in him. Amen? Amen. Come on, folks. One more time. Give the Lord praise. Glory to God. Well, I did it again. I'm getting you out by 12. You can't beat that, boy. I'm telling you. Tell you, y'all might beat the Baptist folks to church tonight. I mean, the restaurant today. Just picking. Don't nobody get offended. It's all right. God's good. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and his grace rest on you. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, bless your people. Keep them. Help them, Lord, to be back with us at the next appointed time. God, help us to walk in the fullness of who you are. God, to come out from behind the facade of shame and guilt. God, just to be free and liberated because you bore that iniquity for us, God. You bore that shame. You bore our griefs. You bore our sorrows, God. You carried that stuff. We don't have to carry it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the promise of your word and the fullness of who you are in us. We bless your name today. We give you all the glory and the praise and the honor. We ask it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Take about 5 minutes, fellowship with some folks.